Hi, this is Holly Lisle. I'm starting a little bit early and with a picture of the screen that you need to go to get your download, just because it's going to take a few minutes for everybody to get their download. I'm not really here yet, but the download is. If you will go to your pop-ins in the menu on your right, you will see the download page. Just click through to the download page, and the download is the blue button up here at the top. Everybody should be able to get this. Actually, everybody will be able to get this the second I fix the thing that I didn't fix. Edit. All right. And the answer to that is yes. And yes, update. All right. Now, now everybody can get the download right here. Did I save that? Date. Just in case. I'm a little paranoid. I want everybody to be able to get the download because we're going to be working from the worksheets a little bit today. So, okay, once again, for people who are just getting here, I have opened the door a little bit early because there is a download and I have it ready for you now. If you go to pop-ins, you will see the pop-in on the right-hand side of the page. It says download page. If you click that, you will go to the image that is on the screen in front of you, and right up at the top in the left-hand corner, you will see a blue button that says download. Click that and get your download. Okay, so, and folks are showing up a little early too. This is good. If you get the download early, you have a much better chance of getting it without crashing the site. It is 2.7 megs, so it shouldn't take most folks with good broadband connections very long at all. Okay. All right, so one more time, just because people are coming in the pop-ins menu on the right side of your screen, you have a worksheets link with a download page. The download page is the page that I am currently showing right in the screen in front of you, and the download itself is in the top left corner underneath the blue button. If you click the blue button, you will get the download. And you should not, you should get this in a separate window so that you don't lose your place here. And when I see a few more folks in, I will repeat the announcement one more time. I know this is a little boring, but thank you for getting here early. The more folks who show up a little early, the less chance we have of crashing the How to Think Sideways site. Okay, we have about 3 minutes until the chat actually goes live. And this is Holly, and I am waiting for some more folks to show up. We have the download in the top right corner. You'll see pop-ins. Click pop-ins, go to the download page, and the download page is what is currently showing on the screen. Go ahead and click the blue button at the top of the download page, and that will give you the worksheets that we are going to be, and the diagrams that we are going to be going through and talking about today. Okay, I'm glad to see that this is working for folks. That's kind of exciting. Okay, I fixed it so that you shouldn't have to log in. So, okay, I'm going to do the announcement here one more time. In 1 minute when we officially go live. All right. This is Holly Lisle, and we are now live with Marketing for Writers and Other Stuff. If you click the pop-ins in the right-hand side of the menu, you will see a link to a download page. And if you look on your screen, you see the download page, and you see that in the top left-hand corner, there is a blue button that says download. This is the live chat. If you go ahead and download these now, you will be able to follow along as I work through the different things that we're going to be talking about today. And with that, I'm going to open this back up to the chat room, and I'm going to stop presenting. Stop screen sharing. Okay, now I'm live, and I was a little too close to the picture there. Okay, the next thing I've got for you, and because things are working today, because I have practiced and know how stuff works a little bit better, I have a poll for you. And I have set the poll to live. When this is done, you will be able to see the answers. But this is, do you have any finished manuscripts that you haven't published? In yes, why? If that answer is yes, why haven't you published them yet? So go ahead and quickly think about that and answer that. Don't know how to revise. Right. Okay, stuff is flying in. Okay, well, while you guys are answering the poll, what I've got here is a bunch of questions, primarily about marketing and indie versus commercial publishing and a couple of other very cool things that we are going to be talking about. Okay, so the first question that I have is, how should time be split between writing and marketing? Is it a 50-50 thing? Does it change over time? That is, do writers need to spend more or less time marketing as time goes on? I'm coming down, in spite of the fact that this is not what I do, this is what I am working very hard right now at getting to do. I want to change my writing to marketing time to about 90% writing and 10% marketing. And I have Dan building me some special software for that. And because folks were interested, those who are interested are on a special mailing list, and they are starting to do some beta testing for him on that software. But my objective is to only do my work once, to write, to have everything set up, to have, to be able to just highlight sections of what I've written that day in the same software that I'm doing my marketing from, to post that as blog posts or as Twitter feeds or as something to my newsletter, depending on what I wrote, depending on the context or the content. And writing is what feeds you. Marketing is what introduces people to your writing. But writing, the act of writing and creating products, stories, novels, flash fiction, just whatever it is that you write, the act of writing and revising and getting it out there is the only thing that can pay you. You can't sell marketing unless you are selling a marketing course. Marketing pays you secondhand. If you don't have something to sell, there's no point in marketing. And this is where an awful lot of people are getting hung up. So the first thing that I'm going to do here now is I want to show you another screen. Okay, I want to screen share this. Okay. And if you downloaded the worksheets today, you will recognize what I have here. The first question you ask yourself in whether you should be writing or promoting is, do I have a product yet? If you don't have a product, then you write your products. And as you write your products, you talk to people. Now, on the internet, you have two ways to do that that actually work, that I can prove actually work. They have worked wonderfully for me. The first thing you do is, well, you figure out what you love. You bring in the folks who love what you love. You figure out what you hate. You weed out the folks who love what you hate. And you write about what you love. And when you do this, you do it by building a blog and building a mailing list. Now, these are all things that you're doing while you are writing fiction before you have anything sold, before you have anything published. You figure out what you love, you figure out what you hate, you write about what you love, you write about what you hate. Okay, and the reason you do this is because you want to weed out the people who will hate what you do before they spend money. Because before they spend money, what you will get is "I hate you" comments on your blog. After they spend money and hate what you do, if you have fought so hard to keep, your readers and all readers, and you're trying to appeal to everyone, then the second that you create, you bring your work out, and the people that you fought so hard to keep hate it because they hate what you love, then you are going to get "I hate you" reviews. And "I hate you" reviews will hurt you. "I hate you" comments won't. The fun thing about having a blog is that if they really bother you, you can always delete them. You can't touch "I hate you" reviews. And "I hate you" reviews will cost you sales. So, okay, one more time on the process here. If you have no product, your job, aside from writing your fiction every single day, is to figure out what you love and write about that. Figure out what you hate and write about that, and be honest about it. You write about both of these things, you build a blog, you build a mailing list, and you weed out the people who will hate what you do before they spend money. Okay, now, once you have products, and before we're done with this, I am going to help you create some products that you can sell very quickly. The product, once you have a product, you promote to your readers. Now, if you are going, "What readers?" then you go back to the list over here. You have to start to talk to people. Now, this is, a lot of people start by writing fiction, and that's great, okay? But it's the same process either way. Then, once you have something to promote, however, you actually can promote. So along with your blog, along with your mailing list, you create coupons, you create free stuff, you create story snippets. You get character discounts, early buyer discounts. You give insider goodies. And all of this is something that you can say, "Here, this is what I do. It's not going to cost you anything, or it's only going to cost you a little to try it out." And this gives you the opportunity to bring in folks who don't know you yet from other places. You can, if you have an affiliate program, you can ask readers who love your work to say, "You know, look, if you recommend this, if you genuinely like it, if you have read it, and if you recommend it to the folks that, you know, share your particular fiction loves, then you can have half of what I make on everything that you recommend," which is, you know, I've been doing this for years. I have a tiny, tiny affiliate program. I have very few people who do this. But the ones who do genuinely love what I do and recommend it. And I thank them by giving them half of whatever it is that they bring in, because they are giving me the opportunity to talk to people I could not have met any other way. And this, to me, is a very good deal. Okay, once you have done your promotions to your blog and to your mailing list, then you have to make sure that what you are producing is high-quality end products. You have to have good cover art. You have to have an editor who goes through this and checks it. You can use friends. You can use crowdsourcing. You can hire an editor. There are a multitude of ways to do this, but your work must be edited. You have to revise it before it's edited. And you will, if you have a content editor, you're going to have to revise it again after you have edited it, or after it's been edited, and then you're going to have to submit it for a re-edit just for proofing. What you want to do then is the one thing that I can't help you with today, which is once you have this out there, you launch your fiction. And we are still working. I've got a team of writers and me. I have gotten badly wrecked trying to get the website set up for these guys. And I should have it probably by the end of this week now. But we are working on launching fiction. If you have heard about product launches, there are processes and techniques that you can use to go out there and create something that is not fiction and promote it by following these simple steps, and it will sell like gangbusters if it's any good. With the same process and fiction, you get crickets. But there has to be a way to do this. And we have done one launch so far. And the fiction, well, in his case, it wasn't fiction. It was personal nonfiction, an autobiography, and a memoir. And we got him the same number of visitors to his site in the week that we were doing the launch that he had in the entire previous year. He, I think, roughly doubled, possibly tripled the size of his mailing list with new readers who wanted to read what he was doing. Now, he started very small. And with a small launch, you can take your mailing list, if you have 25 people, you can take your mailing list to, in his case, I think about 75. But that's huge. So what we are doing, why is there a standby bar? Okay. Try refreshing. If you have a standby bar, you shouldn't be on standby because this shows for me as live. Just refresh the page. Okay. All right. So, wow, I got a little distracted there. So we are working on developing a system for fiction launches and for personal nonfiction like memoirs, things that simply do not work with regular product launches. I have tried and tried and have failed with those. So now we're trying something different. And if I succeed at it, I will put it together as a relatively inexpensive course, and you can learn how to launch your fiction. All right, so the next thing that we are going to do here is we're going to go to the next page. And another question, okay? I am finishing the revision for my first novel with How to Revise a Novel, and I have written 10 flash stories. Should I already create a blog? What kind of thing do you write on your blog when you are just a beginner with nothing published yet or very little published? How do you make it interesting when you don't have a long list of achievements? Okay, first off, nobody's list of achievements is interesting. Lists of achievements are the most boring things on the planet. How people fail their way to success is interesting, and what you are doing as you create is interesting. Okay, the next thing on this is, yes, you should already have a blog and you should be working on your mailing list. If you have 10 flash stories and your first novel that you are getting ready to bring out, yeah, you need to have had a blog. You need to have been talking to people, but that's okay. I've got the worksheets here. They are far deeper into this particular page and or into the download that I gave. And I am going to walk you through the process of figuring out what to put on your blog and what to put in your newsletters, and what to put in your fiction, because it is, believe it or not, all the same thing. All right, so next question. I've been doing this for a long time. I have book 4 going live soon, book 5 coming out in June. I've tried everything I can think of to get seen, to step out from behind the curtain, to sell. I get good reviews, but not enough. I've advertised, I've blogged, I've used a publicist, I've started a YouTube series. I intend to create an hour-long webinar on nonverbal communication, but I'm losing faith and I'm not sure how to keep going. So my question is, how do I keep striving when I have so little coming back to me? I can't live on less than 100 views. I need 10,000. Okay. This is a case of not having enough product out there to gain traction. You need more than 4 or 5 products. You need more stories out there where people can get them. You don't need more publicity until you have at least 10 separate purchasable items in your Amazon account, in your Smashwords account, in your Barnes & Noble account, in your Apple account, whatever publishing you are using, if you are commercially publishing, you got to be doing this from book one, because if you don't, you are going to sink like a stone. If you are doing this as an indie publisher, though, you have some time and you can allow your fiction to gain traction on its own while you just write more stuff until you have 10 things out there that people can read. And again, I've got a really quick way for you to create 10 separate purchasable products. If you don't have any, and fewer than that, just to fill in your list, if you have a few that are already published, already can be bought, so that you can have enough stuff in there that people can start buying everything you do and recommending you and finding you from the traction of regular sales. Okay, so let's look at that now. Again, I will get to that when we get to the workshop part of this with the worksheets. So what we're looking at now is, what are the pros and cons of commercial writing versus self-publishing? And this is where we are right now. Let me scoot this back this way. Okay, there we go. Commercial publishing versus indie publishing. I'm going to start with the pros of commercial publishing first. I have a lot more experience with commercial publishing than I do with indie publishing. I'm not exactly an indie publishing beginner, but when you commercially publish, you usually get an advance. That is benefit number one, such as it is. Now, there are contracts out there now where you don't get an advance, where you supposedly get a percentage of royalties, but I am here to tell you that royalties in this day and in this publishing market are a myth. Do not ever sign a commercial publishing contract where you do not get an advance. Ever. Do not, because you will never see royalties. Benefit number two, you usually get a deadline. Sometimes if you've already got the book written, you won't have a deadline. Sometimes if your publisher is just kind of speculating on you, you won't have a deadline. But having a deadline is a good thing for a writer, in that it pushes you to sit your butt in the chair and get your work done. If you don't have a hard deadline, it's very difficult to do this sometimes, and for some folks. Over the course of time, you need to be a self-starter at this. You need to be the person who goes out there and does your work whether you have a deadline or not. One of the things that I discovered about this when I changed publishers and then had my editor quit and not take me with her, so that I had to come up with a bunch of proposals for my agent to sell to other publishers, was that having a really strong work ethic, getting my ass out of bed first thing in the morning, writing 10 to 15,000 words over the course of, well, okay, I guess I was actually doing about 5,000 words a day. Then I sometimes bumped up to 10 every day, and getting proposals to him was the thing that got me sold to another publisher in time for us not to starve. Living on your writing is its own sort of deadline, in that if you're not producing, you don't eat. Okay, so deadline is benefit number two. Benefit number three, such as it is you might get some marketing, but probably not. If you already have a list of 5,000 readers who are buying your books, if you already have 500 people on your Twitter feed, if you already have just have sold at least 5,000 copies of whatever book you've got out there, you can use that as an indie publisher to get a contract with a commercial publisher, because you can prove that you have fans and you can prove that you have traction. Of course, once you have fans and you have traction, I don't know why you would ever consider working with a commercial publisher, but we'll move on to the one reason that I can actually say is a good reason. Oh, by the way, yes. On the might get some marketing thing, I have a horror story. I have horror stories for everything, and we're going to go over some of them. But the majority of writers' first novels are dead in 30 days from the date of publication. They are being stripped and sent back to the publisher. They won't get a second chance. They won't find readers. They won't. And the writer who wrote it will not get another contract. This is the majority. The reason that this works this way is because commercial publishers are still operating on the model of throw spaghetti against a wall and stick to see if it sticks. And this is, if you're a publisher, it's awesome because you can get people for really cheap. You can just try a bunch of things for relatively cheap and somebody will stick and then you just get rid of the rest. If you are someone who is among the rest, they don't care. They don't have any reason to care. You are the person who has to care about you when you're writing. Now, the one thing I can say about commercial publishing that is a true and genuine benefit is that you can say you've been commercially published. If this is the thing that drives you, that you want to have a publisher from Bane to Rock to Tor to anybody that you can, Scholastic, whoever. If you want to say, I can be, I am professionally published by God, then that is the benefit that you can get from this. And it's worth the paper that it's printed on. It doesn't, there's not much else. If your book comes out and dies in 30 days, you can say you've been commercially published and it'll be true, but it's not going to help you sell another book, not to anybody. Okay, now let's move to indie publishing. Okay, first thing first, you own all your rights. Okay, and let me tell you my interesting little story from just 3 days ago about The Secret Texts, which is The Diplomacy of Wolves, Vengeance of Dragons, and Courage of Falcons, three books I wrote relatively early in my career with Time Warner. And I hit a couple of small bestseller lists with them, and they sold very well for a while. But not well enough for my editor to take me with her when she moved to another house. I got my royalty check for those three books from the company that is still selling the ebook versions of them for 6 months. Royalty checks come every 6 months. It was $27. If I had the rights for The Secret Texts myself and was selling print versions of them plus commercial Kindle versions and other EPUB versions, I could make probably around $600 or $700 a month off of those titles. all three of them combined, $150 a book. For every royalty or every royalty statement, royalty statements from Kindle and Barnes and Noble and Apple and places like that are once a month. So, that $27 spread across 6 months is a stab in the side. Every time I get a check from them, it's like, oh, goody. Yay. This is what I could have been making if I had published this myself. Of course, back then there was no self-publishing. So, it's a futile, wishful thing. Okay. Next thing, you start getting royalties immediately. And now this is immediately in the sense that when people start buying your work, you get paid immediately for it. You do have to get the work in front of people, and that can be part of the trick. But again, that's the workshop at the end of this. That's what we're going to do. So you start getting paid immediately as soon as you have readers. If you have been building a blog, if you have been building your mailing list, then you have a pretty good chance of having some readers by the time your first thing comes out. And you probably can sell a few copies, and then you just keep going. Okay. You do your own marketing. And I have a horror story about this too. Book one of my Moon and Sun series, The Ruby Key, did not do as well as the publisher had hoped. And what this means is that the series is dead. But I thought, hey, I can do something about this. I can publish, I can market the crap out of book number two. And I set up a video contest where people could, I gave the first half of the book to anybody who wanted to download it and allowed them to create videos or set it up so that people could create videos about it. And I was going to give away $1,000 spread among like three people. This was And $1,000 spread among three people is a pretty big thing. Scholastic threw a shit fit. They said, no, you absolutely cannot do this. First of all, if kids do this, then there will be legal repercussions. You can't give them cash. So I said, no problem. I will, if anybody who is under 18 does this, then I will create separate prizes for them. No, you absolutely cannot do this. This is off the reservation. You cannot give away the first half of your book. You have to take this down immediately so that there are no lawsuits. The lawsuits at this point, I think, being against me for allowing people to read the first half of the book. Okay, so the second book didn't sell. It didn't sell. I mean, it was just pathetic. I could have saved that book, I think. I could have got it more readers than the first book, which might have been enough to make the third book doable for me. Because what I heard after the second book did not do as well as we had hoped, which is the line that you will hear from commercial publishers forever. What I heard was, well, we are going to cut the series from 7 down to 3. You can write the last book, but you are going to have to take a significant pay cut to do it. And because I live on my writing, I couldn't afford to do a significant pay cut in order to write the third book. So that was when I started putting together my stuff for writers and selling that. Okay, so if you are indie publishing, you get to do your own marketing. You have to be a little careful about anything that you are marketing to kids. This is really, really important. But if you are marketing stuff to adults, and if you are setting up contests with prizes and things like this for adults, you are pretty much limited by your own imagination, and whatever is decent won't get you arrested. Next benefit, you get direct, immediate feedback from your readers. Okay, little horror story on this. It took me 6 months, sometimes 8 months, to get letters that were mailed, fan letters that were mailed from my publisher to me, whereas I get emails from my readers all the time. So directly to me, and I love that. You get direct, immediate feedback from your readers. That is a huge benefit. You get all your sales numbers all the time. If you have ever tried to read a commercial publisher's royalty statement, all of the critical information is not there. Bain is the exclusion. Bain, and I don't know if this is true anymore, but when I was working with Bain was the sole publisher who allowed you to see the numbers that would let you know things like what your sell-through was. That was how I found out that my sell-through with Bain was 97% with some of my titles, which is just mind-boggling. It was awesome. And once I switched to another publisher, I have no idea what my sell-through on anything is anymore for anything that is commercially published. You can't tell from the statements. You can't tell how much money you should be getting. Things like basket accounting happen, so that if you have a bestseller, which I did with Midnight Rain, and it is basket accounted with the next two books, then you don't have a bestseller because the next two books will sell fewer. Your royalties are based on what everything does rather than what the sole title does. Okay, that's enough of those horror stories. Let's move on. Your accountant works for you. Understand when you work for a commercial publisher that the commercial publisher's accountant works for the publisher. It is the job of the accountant to make the publisher as profitable as possible. And that means that anything that can be taken out of your end legally will be. So you're not looking for ways to cut corners on yourself. If you are indie publishing, you get to keep your money, and this is a very good thing. Your stories, number 7, are your stories at your length with your characters, your theme, and your plot. And I have a bunch of horror stories about this. But the one that everybody hasn't actually heard yet was the one about Glenraven, which I wrote supposedly in collaboration with Marion Zimmer Bradley, but she had had a stroke and was dying. So I ended up writing the book for both of us. And I wanted to write a lesbian main character. And my publisher at the time just went bananas, said, absolutely not. We do not want to win a Lambda Award. Make the main character something else. So I made the main character Wiccan. Actually, I think that was Glenraven number 2. Anyway, when you are writing your own stories, you get to make the characters that you want to write. You get to write the book the way you want to write it. It can have your theme. It can have your plot. It can say what matters to you. And you will not be told, no, you can't write that. Do it differently. You know, the other story that everybody knows is, well, okay, we'll get onto that later. You own your backlist, which means your books don't go out of print. And I cannot tell you how huge that is. There are things that have gone out of print on me only to come back with an EPUB version only that I can't touch because the publisher's still on rights to them and they're doing a shitty job of marketing them and a lousy job of getting them into people's hands. They have it doesn't matter to them because I'm not writing new books for them. I don't have a front list. So it's just going to sit there. And this will make you crazy if you are publishing commercially. Your books will not stay in print, and there's nothing that you can do to keep them in print. Let's see. You own your career. And with that, this means that if you want to do a 7-book series, you can do a 7-book series. It won't be canceled at 3 or 2. That you get to say how many books in a series you write, that you get to say, well, I have been doing YA. Now I want to do adult fiction. I want to do science fiction. I think that I would really like to jump over and do some romance. I've done all of those things. And the thing is, I can do any of them at any time. And nobody says no. Nobody gets to say no. I'm the person who gets to say, this is what I'm going to write. Thank you very much. Your editor works for you. Okay, now this is the story of Hawksbar, wherein my editor at Tor told me to cut 70,000 words from the book. The book was roughly 200,000 words long. And she said it had to come down by 70,000 words to be kept in one volume. So I looked hard. I tried to cut, but I write very lean in first draft. And I couldn't cut. And in fact, when I went through it, I ended up adding an extra 30,000 so that the book was now 230,000 words because I had left out so much stuff in the first draft. So I said, look, I can't find a place to cut this. If you can find a place to cut it, let me know what these places are and I will go in and cut them. So I waited and I waited and I waited. And the week before the book was due, well, no, 11 days before the book was due to be turned back in for publication, I got a copy of the manuscript in the mail, and it had been edited without me. It had been cut to the specified number of words. And the way this editor had done it was to remove my second main character. The story has at its heart a romance. It is a fantasy novel with a romance at the heart of it, and she had removed the male lead. This broke the story. You can imagine that if you remove one of the two core characters of the story will in fact break, and it did. And the copy editor had went through it and said, well, you know, this character shows up in the middle of the book, and why? He seems important. Why wasn't he at the beginning of the book? And I went nuts. This is the time that I went to war over a book. We'll get to that later. But that was the book, and that was why. If your editor works for you, your editor can't tell you have to cut 70,000 words or I'll cut it for you and then remove your main character. Your artist works for you, which means that your vision of who the characters are is going to be what's on the cover. I'm going to skip the horror story on that one. Cadence Drake, first cover, it was pink and purple. This was a hard science fiction novel. This was a space opera with some really cool hard tech in it. And it came out with a pink and purple cover and didn't sell as well as we had hoped, quote unquote. You can reach out directly. You can fix things. In When the Bow Breaks. No, it wasn't When the Bow Breaks. So another book that I wrote, I had a television station wrong in the book that a TV show was on. And if that had been self-pubbed, I could have gone in and fixed that, and later readers could have gotten it. As it is, it's out there with the broken stuff out there. Now, I am doing a new version of it now because the rights have reverted to me. In the new version, it will be correct. Okay, you can reach out directly to your readers and give them reasons to find you. And you do this by putting a page in your book with a live link to your website and or to your mailing list and a thing that says, this is the freebie you will get when you sign up to my mailing list. And you can't do that with a commercial publisher's website. They won't let you. They're going to be promoting your book and everybody else's book, not just your stuff. Okay, so that is commercial publishing versus indie publishing. I know that was long, but it is incredibly important. So let's move on to some of these other questions. Is it even possible? Oh, wait, how do I start self-publishing and how do I protect my stories while doing so to make sure I get all the credit for writing them? There is a website that is linked at the back of the download, the worksheet downloads. And I think it's time for me. I'm going to end the poll now. Okay, so that you guys can see the results of the poll. And I'm going to go over to the pop-ins. And if you go to the pop-ins, you will see a download for the worksheets. And if you have not already downloaded them, you need to download them now. So just go to the download page. They are in the top left corner under a blue button, and download. All right, then. From that, when you go to the very last page of the handout that I gave you, you will see two links. And the first link is for copyright.gov help FAQ. And this will tell you what you need to know about copyright. It's important. It's useful, and it's in plain English, so for a government website, it was pretty impressive. Okay, then back from pop-ins, back from polls, where everybody's got their answers all up there, and you can see them now. Let's go to the worksheets. And again, if you don't have the worksheets, you can download them from the site later. They will still be there. They're going to be on a separate page, though. Let me do this here. Okay, and I'm just going to walk you through the process here with the worksheets, because this is the answer to the question, is it even possible to sell fiction through? No. How do you do this? How do you market your work? And this is how you market your work. This is how you write your work. It is the same process. Everything you do applies to everything else, which is why I'm working so hard on building One Step, is because I have figured this out and I want everything I do to apply to everything that I do, with just me being able to click buttons and make it all happen. Okay, so anyway, here we go. There are four questions you need to ask yourself. What do you love? What do you hate? What do you desire? And what do you fear? And as you work your way through these worksheets, what you are looking for is 2- and 3-word answers that you can put in comma-separated lists. Okay, these give you not just the things that you write about on your blog and the things that you write about in your newsletters and the things that you tweet about on your Twitter account. These also give you the stories that you write, because what you love, what you hate, what you desire, and what you fear should be the core of what you write, because it matters to you. And anything can go on here. Anything. The only criteria here is that it matters to you personally, because fiction is a personal thing. Okay, people are still getting an error when they try to download. Okay, I will fix that. Hang on, let me see if I can fix that right now. Update this. No. Okay, that's why. I'm sorry. Click the wrong button. Update this. Okay, you do not need to be a member, and it will not open in your browser. Okay, so that is updated. Okay, let me know. You should now, immediately, right this minute, be able to download those worksheets. Okay, so check and let me know. I am watching. Okay. Okay, offer download link, an orange button there. Nope. All right. Okay, somebody posted the link. Cool. All right, is that working for you guys now? Okay, the download is going to download to whatever you have set as your download folder. Okay, just worked. Good. All right. That solves that. Okay, so sorry about the error. That was all me. That was me checking two wrong buttons. Yay. Excellent. Okay. Now, we are on page one of the worksheets. I was still putting these things together today, so that's why you get my hand-drawn worksheets rather than something a little bit more professional. But they will still work. You refresh the download page if it doesn't work and try the button again. Yeah. Okay, let's go back to this. These are the questions that you answer, and you just come up with as many things, as absolutely positively many things as you can put on this list. Okay? And just be passionate about it. Okay? Once you have done that, you're going to go in here and you are going to create titles. Create titles of 3 to 10 words for the different things that you have on the first page that you love, that you hate, that you fear, that you desire. And you just write the titles in the columns. Think of blog posts, newsletters, story titles, all of them. Yeah, some of them are sideways. You're going to have to change them in your... Just print them out. yeah, if you have a good PDF program, you can rotate them. But yeah, the first two are sideways, the rest are vertical. Or something is... I have all of mine the way I wanted them. Okay, anyway. Once you have created titles for all of this stuff, then this is what you create. You create the work that goes with titles. And let me see if I can shrink this down just a little bit more so that I can get the whole thing onto the screen. Okay, there's the whole thing. Okay, what you are going to do with these titles and all of the cool stuff that you are doing here is you are going to create, if you don't have at least 10 titles that you are currently selling, front list and back list, then you need to get your list of works up to 10. The 10 seems to be a good number for traction, where people start not just finding your work and recommending it to other people, but also buying more of the work that you have created. Okay? And if you have fewer than 10, then you will note that the second link at the back of this sheet is for my free course, How to Write Flash Fiction That Doesn't Suck. And this is honest to God free. You don't need to give a credit card number. You don't need to buy a single thing. You will be able to access this course and the forms that go with it for free, because this is just something that is essential to writers. And I decided that this was going to be my gimme. You have to know how to tell a story well, and this will tell you how to tell a story well. And you have to know how to do a good beginning, a good ending, and a good middle. And this takes you through step by step how to do each of those things in 500 words. So it does not take you a long time to do this. And when you have done 10 stories, you have a 5,000 word anthology that you can sell. And people like these. They are a lot of fun to read. You make them inexpensive. If you're just getting started, make them 99 cents. I have bumped my first one down to $1.99 now, and I will bring out my new one at $2.99. And when it's been out for about a year, I'll bump it down to $1.99. You can charge more for your front list, and you should, because it's only front list for about a year. Publish everything. There's a question here. You mean don't publish your story until you have 10 things? No, get everything up there, because some things will sell on their own. You can start getting a few reviews. You can start, but you don't start getting traction. You don't start getting people who actually find you and recognize you until you have written about 10 things and have enough stuff up there that when people click on your name, they get a whole page with stuff that is yours, a whole page of your stuff. That's what you're shooting for on Amazon, on Barnes & Noble, on whatever you're working on. You are shooting for an entire page with just you and just your fiction on that page. Okay, once you have at least, and while you are doing this, you do a weekly blog, you do maybe a monthly email to your newsletter, and you just keep going, okay? Now, once you have at least 10 fiction titles in print for sale on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Apple, Smashwords, etc., set up your own bookshop on your site. And the reason you do this is because you need to be able to make money every day. Now, royalties every month are awesome, especially when they're compared to royalties every 6 months that are $27. Royalties every month are great, but you need to have, as a writer, an emergency backup fund. And you have your own shop for this. You have a shop that just goes to PayPal, that just goes to Stripe, that puts money in your bank account every single day from your shop. And you don't touch that money. That money sits in there so that when your car breaks down, you have something that you can get it fixed with. When you get sick and you have an expensive medication that you have to buy, you have that money that you fall back on. This is your buffer. And until you are making a significant amount of money a month, this money that comes in every day that you can get your hands on that day, that you can put into your bank every day if you need to and just save in savings, that is your lifesaver. So, okay, once you have 10 titles, once you are up, once you are starting to sell, you create your own shop and you sell all your stuff on your shop, okay? And then you blog and you build your mailing list and you promote to your mailing list with a coupon sale to your readers on your site for your bundled work. You give them a deal because your readers, the people who are on your mailing list, those are the people who you get to talk to. The people who read your blog, those are the people that you get to talk to who come to see you and you thank them. You give them discounts. You give them freebies. You give them cool stuff because these are your guys and you want to treat them well. Once you have once you have some pretty good traction from the stuff that is selling, you have maybe 15 or 20 titles up there, Or once you have at least 10, you build an interesting series of newsletters about your characters, about your stories, and so on. You offer a freebie story and you increase the promotion of your mailing list. Maybe send out something cool once every 2 weeks instead of once a month. Always let your readers know when you've got something new coming out. I'm terrible about this. I have done a horrible job of marketing my fiction. But this is something that, again, Dan is going to help me out with this by getting me away from doing websites, and I'm going to get back to writing fiction, and I am so excited. I am going to split my time 50-50 between fiction and nonfiction, and I am going to let the websites market for me. Okay, so the thing that you want to remember most of all is that your job as a writer is to sing for your supper. If you are not creating fiction, then you are not working. Marketing is not working. Marketing is just selling the work you did. You don't get paid to market. You get paid to write, and you pay in your time to market. So the more time that you spend on writing and the less time that you spend on marketing that still gets you results, the better off you are. Okay, be interesting. If you are writing about stuff you love and stuff you hate and stuff that moves you and that you are passionate about, stuff that you desire, stuff that you fear, you will be interesting. Be honest. Show people who you really are. There are places on my blog where I get actively pissed off. And, you know, I have been told that that's not good for me because people then think less of me because I am not this calm, even-tempered, always good-humored writer. Well, damn it, I'm not. I am not. So why should I be pretend to be someone that I'm not? I get pissed off in my books sometimes too, and I write the truth about things that make me angry in life, and I put these in a fictional context. But I'm writing about things that matter to me. I do it on my blog. I do it in my newsletters. I do it in my fiction. If you are writing about what truly matters to you, you will be interesting. You can be honest. You can be passionate. And you can be real. Just don't be a dick. Okay, so that's all of that. And I still have... Close this out. And okay, now I'm back. And I'm going to go through a few more of the questions here, and then I'm going to take some of your questions. So if you have questions, I've seen things, well, maybe Holly will chime in on this, just kind of scrolling off on the left-hand side. If it's not in the question, I'm going to miss it. So if there's something that you want to know, please put it in the questions. You know, just click the little orange question and answer bar that bumps it over into that second column for me, and I will get it as soon as I can. Okay, and from that, let me go ahead and do a few more of these questions here. If you are offered a traditional publishing offer, should you take it or should you self-pub? Over the long haul, you'll make more from self-publishing, unless you are just ungodly lucky. You are not going to make as much money from a traditional publishing offer. There is nothing that publishing could offer me these days that I would accept. That commercial publishing could offer me. I've been there. I've seen how it works, and it's just not worth it. Let's see. Is there a viable way of being published and being paid for my writing? Yeah, self-publishing. It is work. Don't think that you're going to write your first story and go out there and make $1 million off your first story. It is work. You have to commit to writing regularly, putting out new fiction regularly, and you don't have to spend a lot of time promoting, but the promoting that you do has to be good. Is there a traditional path for short stories? Yeah, magazines. What are the pitfalls? The pitfalls are that you frequently have about a year's wait time until you can put those stories out yourself. And the pay for magazines is almost always very, very tiny. Whereas if you put it out as a book for yourself, my little... You know, I don't generally talk numbers, but my little 10-story flash fiction thing that I did that was selling at was selling at $2.99 after the 99-cent intro price, that is now back down to $1.99 because it's now backlist, has earned me over $1,000, and that's 5,000 words of fiction. You are not going to get $5,000 for short fiction that you write in any other way. So yes, you can get published in magazines. But do you really want to? Because then you're going to have to wait a year before you can sell stuff. And that's a year that you are not making any more money on it. And if it's a good short story, you know, you can sell it for $1.99 or $2.99, especially if it's a longer short story, 10 to, you know, 15,000 words, something like that. And over time, this stuff adds up. It adds up every time somebody buys something. It just keeps accruing. It doesn't go away. It isn't dead the month after the magazine comes out. It is your thing. It is part of what feeds you. And it's out there working for you every single day. This is the magic of self-publishing. This is a wonderful, wonderful thing. Okay. How long can a short story be before being considered a novella? Oh, God. I didn't do this, and I don't remember these offhand. If you look up novel, novella, novelette, you can get the numbers for it. Just search it on Google or wherever, and you will get... It's a variable number, but it's not all that variable. I think up to 10,000 words is a short story, and then after 10,000 to like 20,000 or 30,000 is a novelette, and then after that you're basically looking at a novella. So, you know, but that's off the top of my head, and I didn't research this, so check it. Let's see, is there a traditional, okay, would you use or create a magazine for publishing your work? I got my ass handed to me for trying that. I was setting up to do these serial fiction magazines under the name Rebel Tales. And I had already gotten a bunch of people who wanted to submit. I had already gotten a bunch of people who wanted to work on it. And okay, thank you. Somebody published the short story, the novelette word count thing. Go ahead and just post that as a question, would you please, Aaron? And I will bump it over into the live questions so people can see the answer. Anyway, Rebel Tales. You know, it was before Amazon opened up its sales for independent writers. So what I had was my idea for what became Amazon. And you know, it was going to be all EPUB, and it was going to come out with people were going to each editor was going to have her own series of writers, her own stable. And she was going to, or he was going to publish the serialized fiction in monthly form over a period of X number of issues, and then the issues would close, and then the editor would come up with a new concept and a new issue, and it was really cool. It was, I think, it was when there wasn't really any content for e-readers, and I think it would have done really well. And here's what happened. This woman came in with a fake name and talked me, you know, presented her very good application for being one of my editors and stole the fiction of a couple of writers. And I managed to talk to those writers and you know, they got their copyrights in, made sure that you know, they had that she wouldn't be able to use it or publish it. But I realized that there are some things that you can do online and some things you can't. And I decided that one of the things that I couldn't do was risk everything that I owned on people who could be lying to me. That hurt. I still love the idea of Rebel Tales, and it kills me that I didn't get to do that. I think it would have been wonderful. And, you know, one person killed it. And, you know, if I had her real name, I probably would have sued her. I didn't. All I had on her was fake information. No, I wouldn't look at anything else with magazines. That was too hard. All right, let's see. Where are great places to start to get published? Now this is a commercial publishing question. Who pays? How much? How much can I expect to make? And how are you getting deals and making money? I walked away from deals. Deals suck. You can expect to make almost nothing. The first publication contract when I was getting started was $5,000. That was what you could expect for about a year's work, $5,000, and that was lowball. It is now sometimes $1,000 or $2,000, and this is in today's dollars versus back in 1991 when a dollar was worth a hell of a lot more. And sometimes the publishing contract is, well, we're not going to give you any money in advance, but once the book earns out, we'll pay you royalties. Okay? And it is the job of the accountant to make sure a book never earns out. So screw that. Don't do it. Who pays? Your readers pay. Indie publish. Your readers who pay by buying your work directly because they like it are the only people you need. And great places to start getting published, you are your great place to start. Again, you know, if being commercially published is the thing that you want to do, and that is the only thing you're working for, is to say, hey, I am commercially published. Knock yourself out, but do not expect that this is going to be something that will pay you well, and expect that it is something that is going to be almost just hellish impossible to get done just because publishers now are looking for people who have a 500 person Twitter list and a 1,000 or more, 5,000 person mailing list, and you know, a blog with maybe 1 million hits a year, because they know that these people have traction. If you aren't that person, then you need to become that person before you can sell to a publisher. It's things have changed. The magic model of write a book and send it off to a publisher, and then write another book and send it off to a publisher, and never have to do anything else but that, is gone. It will not come back. So what you need to look at now is the reality of, if I want to do this, do I want to be published commercially, or do I want to get paid? Okay, and then from that, if you are determined that you want to look for publishers, the first thing that you do is you look on the copyright pages of commercially published books. And generally, you want print publication books. And then you want to, after you have found books that you like, that are in the genre that you are writing, that have copyrights, or that have the publication information for those publishers, then the next thing you want to do is go to a site called Predators, or Editors and Predators, with Predators spelled P-R-E-D-I-T-O-R-S, so that if you just want to look it up, that's the way to find it. And then check to make sure that that publisher is not on the Predators list, because horrible, horrible things can happen to your fiction if it gets into the hands of phony publishers. And there are a bunch of them out there who are trolling for your business, and you will lose all your work if your work falls into their hands, and you will lose a bunch of money if you believe what they're pitching at you. So, okay, first, commercially published books. Look for the publisher's name, and then check Editors and Predators to make sure that they are not on that list. Okay, beyond that, are there specific publishers a person wants to take note of in the sci-fi fantasy world, if only going the traditional publisher route? Yes, Bain, Tor, Donald Wolheim, which is Daw Books. Bain, Tor, and Daw. Those are the ones who love what you do and will basically treat you right. You don't want to be the second class citizen of some of these other publishers who deride what you're doing and think that literary fiction is where it's at, and you are just the scum who are paying for the literary fiction writer's big crappy book. My question is regarding the series of novels. You've mentioned in your How to Write a Series course, which is great, by the way, thank you, that a publisher cut short your series at the third book instead of 7, as you'd planned it. Can you continue to publish your series at your expense, indie style, from here, or will it be violating legal bonds you had with the publisher? Thanks. Okay, this is a good question. The series that is being discussed here is Moon and Sun. The first book was The Ruby Key. The next is The Silver Door. And following that is going to be The Emerald Sun, because yes, I finally got my rights back. I finally got permission back to publish the rest of the series under my own imprint. And I'm going to do the third book as a series wrap up for the first two books. And if it does well enough that it will be worth my while, then I will do the fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh books as a second series. Because like you, I have to be paid for my work. And I know that my Cadence Drake stuff sells. And I know that my Longview stuff sells. And I can do really well just doing those. So if I'm going to add back my YA series, I have to know that it will pay me as well as Cadence Drake or Longview. And then I have some other stuff that I want to write too. I know people are waiting for Ruby, Redbird from the Core series, and I am going to write her. And I know that there are some people who are waiting for Dreaming the Dead, which is my archaeology immortality single. And I want to write that too. But again, that's waiting for me to have a way to write and to spend my time about half and half on writing fiction and writing nonfiction, and to spend almost none of my time on marketing and still get the marketing done. So, all right, now, from that, we've got a bunch of questions. All right. I'm not sure whether these go from... All right, I'm going to start from the top and hope that that is the right way to do this. Okay, so from the top here, that's terrifying. That question just disappeared. Chat, pop-ins, videos. Chat, let me see if I can see it. Wow, that is just beyond annoying because I can't see the question that was just asked and I didn't read it because... No, refreshing doesn't help. Okay, I'm going to have to open a second browser and use my own link from my own email to be able to see the question that I just asked. I'm going to have to come in there as one of you guys. Okay, so let me use Opera. Okay, and get my email out and get the link that I mailed to myself that I sent out to everybody else. Not that one. Stripe. I apologize. This was all running very smoothly, and I didn't realize that it was going to date received today. Let's see. I did not realize that it was going to do that to me. Okay. There's the thing. Let me join in with... All right. No. So the question didn't show up for you guys either? They run off at the bottom? All right. Wow. Okay, there's no... Okay, I can't see the question. I can't see it on yours. I can't see it on mine. Okay, so I just won't show the questions on the page. I don't know what that question was, and I am very sorry that I can't answer it, but I can't see it, and I can't get it back. So the next question is, didn't you say once that a book or two of yours were to be turned into screenplays and you were writing the screenplays? If so, can you say how that's progressing and if that is indeed happening? I had someone who was interested in doing them, and then I realized that it would be spending too much of my time doing something that was going to be for an on-spec thing for a filmmaker who was just getting started, and I couldn't afford to spend the time to do it. So that's not happening. If I could, you know, if I had somebody offer to buy one of the books, or the film rights for one of the books, I would be willing to sell them, but it's got to be, it would have to be something a little bit more than on spec. So let's see, next question is, Todd, my 4 short stories, 5,000 words each, haven't been selling at 99 cents. Should I give one away for free? Currently, I give them all away for free to people who sign up for my mailing list and have accumulated 100 emails. Okay, well, no, you shouldn't. you should write more stories. You need to have 10 up, and you need to have one that's free, and you need to have the other three that are for 99 cents is fine while you're getting started, but you need to have 10, and some of the later stuff make it a little bit longer. Sell it for $1.99 so that by the time you are writing stories that are maybe 20,000 words, you can sell them for $2.99 and get the 70% royalty off Amazon. Other places you get the regular royalty for everywhere, but Amazon is the big horse in this. And they're the one who is going to, at least by my experience, they are the one who brings in the most money every month. So figure that, you know, for a lot of your work, you don't want to be making 30% royalty for very many of your books. But focus on writing more. Focus on getting more stuff out there. And once you have 10 things out there, don't give away all your stuff to your mailing list either. Okay? Don't do that. Have one, give coupons so that folks can buy the stuff on your mailing list for a better price than what they're getting from Amazon. And for the 99 cents stuff, you're going to have to go for around 66 cents, because anything less than that and you're going to be paying PayPal. It's going to cost you money to sell your books. But as you increase your productivity and as you increase your prices, that will help you. Okay, any advice on dealing with copyright infringement and pirate sites? The pirate sites are operating legally because they are operating out of countries that don't have copyright law. If you find a copyright or a pirate site that is operating in the United States, you can get them hung up by their tender parts. But for the most part, no. There's absolutely nothing you can do about it. It sucks. It is unfixable because there are countries who do not ascribe to copyright law and who are happy to harbor pirate sites and to allow works to be stolen from these sites. It fits within their world philosophy. Okay. Do you have an opinion on where the best place to go is for creating physical books for sale in addition to digital books? I am currently using CreateSpace, but I got to tell you, I loved Lulu. CreateSpace, I don't think, does quite as nice a book as Lulu did. And with Lulu, you have a couple of options that you don't have from CreateSpace. The thing here is that with CreateSpace, it's easier to get the book onto places like Amazon and Barnes & Noble and stuff like that. If you're using Lulu, it's tougher because, Amazon and Barnes & Noble both have their own print publishing programs now. With Lulu, it's a standalone site, and though it does very nice quality books, you have their shop and you have whatever links you can sell from your site. So, you know, you have CreateSpace, you have whatever the thing is that Barnes & Noble has now. I know people who hire actual print publishers. I have no experience with this, and so I can't recommend anyone, but I really liked Lulu. And that's lulu.com. Do you have an opinion? Okay. Okay, I'm going to try this. This is the short story word count. It is 1,001 to 4,000 words for a short story. Long short story is 4,001 to 8,000 words. Novelette is 8,001 words to 17,500 words. Novella is 17,500 words to 40,000 words, and a novel is 40,000 words and up, which surprises me because I thought a novel was 50,000 words and up. Anyway, okay, I'm going to put this up on the screen and hope that you guys can see it. And if you can't, I apologize, but I tried. Next question here. How many of your short stories have you expanded into longer works? None. I have one that I want to, and that is Rewind, which I started that out as a book with the title on my blog. I refer to it as Secret Project C. And I just did the first chapter of it as a short story, and that has gone very well. And a lot of people have said, yeah, you know, I'd like to read the whole book. but I haven't had time to do it yet. So none going on one is how many of my short stories I've expanded into longer works. Let's see. I am told that I really should get traditionally published with my first book before going indie to have some credibility. What do you think about that advice? I think it's backwards, because to get traditionally published, you are going to have the easiest time possible by self-publishing some of your work, getting followers, keeping track of your mailing list size, keeping track of how many people buy your books. And when you can go to a publisher with 5,000 books and 5,000 books sold and a mailing list of, you know, 10,000-15,000 people, then you have some bargaining. Otherwise, you're going to get a lousy contract and very, very little promotion. Okay. Do you think using magazines for short stories could be a way to reach new readers? Absolutely. Just make sure that in your byline you get your website. That your URL is in your byline, because you want people to be able to find you. Because if you don't have a way for them to find you, and I recommend your website rather than an email, because spammers will be only too happy to use your email to spam you, then if you don't have that contact point in the magazine, they won't find you. Should a conservative writer try to write liberal ideas? I am being pushed to change my stories, and I do not want to, but I was told I would sell more if there was a superwoman in them. Fuck that. Yeah, I said that. Fuck that. Write what matters to you. Don't ever let anybody tell you that you have to write something else. That goes for if you are a liberal writer and somebody is telling you you need to be more conservative. Write what you need to write. Write the stories that matter to you. When you talk about having a product in print, do you mean that literally, or do you consider an ebook being in print? Ebooks are print. Ebooks sell better than print books by a bunch. For every one print book that I sell about 300 ebooks. Okay, what software do you use to sell your page? Okay, I am in the middle of the software nightmare from hell. I am using currently WordPress, and I am using currently MemberMouse. MemberMouse is a very nice membership software, but it only allows you to sell one product at a time, which is horrible, because the best software I ever used allowed me to have people could just add stuff to their cart until they were ready to buy. And it was great. Now, there are a couple of different softwares that I have used that were very good, but that didn't work with WordPress. And I was all hell-bent on getting onto WordPress because it was so easy. And it was easy until it started breaking all my stuff. So first off, I no longer recommend WordPress for even a simple blog. At the point where you can move past free, you need something that is better. I don't have anything yet that I can recommend that is better, because I am still on WordPress. I am building better for myself, and that's really, really expensive. But if we can get this thing up and running, it won't be expensive for the people who buy it from Dan. It's just expensive for me, because I'm doing the research and the design and the building and all of the stuff that goes into it with him. Anyway, for other stuff, I can recommend Squirrel Cart if you have a lot of products. It was beautiful. It was this great piece of software. That's Squirrel, Squirrel Cart, CART.com. Another one. Now I can't think of the other one's name, which is a WordPress plugin, and it was very good. But again, it's a WordPress plugin. And I had all of my stuff set up on it. And when the site updated, it broke all of the downloads. And for those of you who have been following along with me, I spent about, a whole week working like 16-hour days for a whole week fixing all of the broken downloads. And I've still got people who are showing up on the site and saying, okay, well, I found a page where there is an orange download button instead of a blue download button, and it's not working, and here's the page. And then I go in and fix that, because that plugin stopped working with WordPress. So I loved WordPress. I really did. And I cannot in good conscience recommend them to anyone at this point. They have gone into this strange sort of automatic update hell, and it routinely breaks the stuff that I'm using. And you don't want to be me now or later in that regard. Okay. What about paperbacks? Hold on, I just saw something there. Paperbacks, ebooks. Okay, I'm assuming that you can set up some kind of auto process once a book is, an item is bought, that it's automatically delivered. Okay, that is your shop software. And again, Squirrel Cart does that. There are a number of WordPress, I gotta get a drink. There are a number of WordPress and other software plugins that will allow you to sell things. I've heard that WooCommerce is very good, but WooCommerce is very, very expensive. The plugin itself is free, but if you use them and you want to take credit cards, you are going to be paying nightmare fees that will screw your profitability. So that's why I haven't even looked at them. I looked at their pricing and went, no. That's not something that an indie writer needs to get into. Let me see. Use to sell your own page. I'm assuming you can set up some. Okay. Right. Oh, as for delivering paperbacks, if you're using Lulu or if you are using CreateSpace, which is the Amazon print on delivery service, or if you're using Barnes & Noble, they'll send it out. You put a link on your page, and people click that link. They go to their site. They buy it on their site, and it gets mailed to them from their site, and you just get the money. Later, not quickly. You get it later, about 2 months after the sale. Okay, when you talk about having a pro... Okay, I already did that one. What software do you use on your own page? Okay. How do you handle some of the legal aspects of self-publishing? Do you have a company like an LLC where you pay yourself as an employee, or do you simply go the self-employment route and not worry about any legal issues that might come up? Neither. I do worry. I am right at the moment. I am a sole proprietor, but I am in the process of getting LLCs right now. I make very, very sure that I get legal advice on the stuff that I do. I make very sure that all of my websites are FTC compliant with the necessary disclaimers. I get those from a lawyer. No. You have to worry. The legal part of this is very important, and you need to pay attention to it. Now, you can do the work as a sole proprietor. And there's no problem with that, but you do still have to pay exactly as much attention to the legal part of it as you do if you are an LLC. And LLCs in Florida, if you are a sole member of an LLC, you don't get I can't even think of what it's called now, but you don't get the coverage for being a business against people with lawsuits anyway. So what you have to do is make sure that you follow the law, and you have to be careful about it from day one. Don't put up a website if you don't have disclaimers on it, and make sure that you have vetted those disclaimers through a lawyer and that the lawyer is willing to stand behind them. All right. Is it ever a good idea to commercially publish your first book to get initial fans and marketing and then transition to self-publishing to have control with later books? Well, that's assuming that the first book goes out and doesn't die in 30 days. The majority of first novels go out. They get no marketing. They get no sales. They are stripped within 30 days and out of print. So and then you don't have the rights to them. And that book is lost to you. That book is dead to you. So yeah, you can do it, and you can try, and you can hope to be the lucky person who sells a bunch of copies of your first novel, but I don't recommend it. I vigorously recommend against it, because you don't own the rights to that book anymore. I mean, you quote unquote own the rights to them, in that you always own your book's copyright, but that copyright is licensed to somebody else and you can't use it. So it is for 35 years, I think, the same as not owning the book. Okay. Aren't self-pubs like KDP exclusive? Okay. Okay, KDP is not exclusive. What is exclusive is KDP Select, okay? Which means if you just go in with the KDP program, and you go in with the Barnes & Noble regular program, and you go in with Smashwords, and you go in with Apple, and you go with all these other places, none of them are exclusive. You can sell your book on all of your platforms, plus your own, and as long as you make everything the same price all the way across, you're not going to get in trouble. If you have your book in KDP Select, that is exclusive. And you can, with it, do like one freebie giveaway per series of several months. It's a long time between giveaways. And you can do one marketing promotion thing. To me, it wasn't worth it. I can do my own marketing, and I'm pretty good at it now. I'm learning. And it would limit me from all the other places where I like to have my books. So, but no, they are, if you are very careful not to join KDP Select, if you're just using KDP and Apple and Smashwords and Barnes & Noble and whatever you have in your country, if you're not in the US, then you're good. Okay, and your own shop. Always have your own shop. From the time you have about three things, maybe five things, start with your own shop. And just, you know, that daily money, man, that buffer that you can create and put into savings and have against emergencies is the best rest that I ever got, man. That was how I started sleeping at nights. Okay, what if you write a bestseller that masses out? Do you let the publisher do the hard work for you? If you write a bestseller, you're golden. You know, the publisher will be happy to pay you a lot of money. The publisher will be happy to promote for you. But that's like playing dice and counting on rolling, what I don't know, I don't gamble. So whatever the perfect dice roll is, like 10 times in a row. You know, it is that difficult, that unlikely, that what you are writing is going to be a bestseller. If you know, and if you write a bestseller that you self-pub, say Wool, for example, W-O-O-L, and oh my God, I can't believe I forgot his name. He is such a good writer, and I have just gone blank on his name now. But he self-published that story. And he has become, he's making, I think, $1 million a month now. And he did that by self-publishing. Okay, he is what is called a black swan. That they exist, they're out there, but you cannot look at them and think, what happened for him is what is going to happen for me. What you have to assume is that you are going to have to work your ass off. And it's not going to be easy, but it's going to be fun. So, you know, focus on that. Focus on the fact that you can do this and you can make it work for you, but it's not a walk in the park. It was not a walk in the park for like 999,000 out of 1 million people. All right. Let's see. Next question here. Claudette, would you consider doing a workshop on who to use, put together a mailing list, and the easiest way to promote it? Well, yeah, I don't know that you really need a mailing list. I mean, this is stuff I can just recommend off the top of my head. I recommend AWeber. It's easy. It integrates with a lot of publishing platforms. They are meticulous about making sure that your emails are clean. They are meticulous about keeping spammers off the list so that your emails will get delivered. There are other places out there. I haven't used them because I got very fortunate with the first recommendation that I took, which was for AWeber, and AWeber has been fantastic for me. For publishing print books, I like Lulu, I like CreateSpace. Hugh Howey, Wool by Hugh Howey. Thank you, Tammy. Yeah. Okay. And putting stuff together, well, we are working on that for readersmeetwriters.com. Okay, big plug. Readersmeetwriters.com is down right now, but I'm going to have it up in a couple of days. It's going to be beta 2. And what we are doing now is working. We've got our first live piece of software for it, which is Zenforo. And we are going to have a live community in there. And we're going to be able to actually start doing some of the things that we have been talking about doing previously with Readers Meet Writers. And the concept of Readers Meet Writers is this. You need to meet readers as a writer. Writers want to find good fiction. And there are some writers, these are the people who will eventually become your and other writers' true fans, who are willing to help writers get that fiction by doing crits, by going out and recommending those books to other people. And what we are doing is building a site where all of the different functions that writers need to have done, they can do for each other, for points that they can do, that readers can help them out with, and that writers give readers cool things. We've discussed various kinds of swag, which is cool bonuses like free, well, not bookmarks. Nobody does bookmarks anymore because, you know, who has pages? But it's cool, okay? And it is readersmeetwriters.com. And I blew it up yesterday while I was doing some upgrading. So the site, there is a thing there that just says, this is where the login page is going to be when I get this to work again. But please join me there because this is where the workshops for things like how to get your book put together are going to start. How to do your own promotion are going to start. Where you are going to be able to find readers to crit for you, where you are going to be able to crit for other writers. One more time on this, readersmeetwriters.com. And that's, so Claudette, we're working on that. Okay, do you have any suggestions on creating a website? I have been struggling with this, WordPress is difficult. Yeah, at the moment I don't. Everything that I used Drupal, I used a couple of other CMSs. I'm trying to remember the name of the one that just absolute Joomla. Oh my God, I hate Joomla. Oh my God, it is everything broken up into 7 million different pieces that you have to publish the title on one page and the article on the other page and decide where you want it to, the category you want it to go to on another page. It is just fractionally horrible. But WordPress is basically the easiest thing out there right now. Again, you know, I'm working on something easier. It's not done. And if you want to get started now, you know, I don't recommend WordPress, but WordPress is the easiest thing out there. For now. Okay. Can you write fiction and nonfiction on the same site? I do. I have articles on writing. I have articles on reading. Now, okay. Now, I give this caveat to everybody. And it's really, really important. If you are writing about writing, you are going to attract writers to your site. If you are writing about writing, you are going to be able to sell stuff about writing. But writers will not buy your books. So if you want to write fiction, then you need to write fiction, and you need to write about your fiction and about your life and about the things that inspire your fiction and about the things that are going into your fiction because they really made you angry or passionate or excited. You need to write to readers because readers are the people who are going to buy your fiction. Writers won't. I have a very, very, very tiny percentage of the people who come to my website who are writers who have actually read any of my fiction. But yeah, with that said, if you want to sell to writers as well as, you know, trying to sell to readers, yeah, you can put them both on the same site. Okay. Is it true that you should not self-publish if you also intend to go commercial? No. No, and you should self-publish first because that'll give you some numbers so that you can negotiate for a better contract. Okay, Holly, can you get to the page without logging in, but the download? Okay, yeah, that's fixed. The download is now working. Okay, so generating my following of my website from my following on social media sites, if I don't have the sales there and rely on Amazon, are you telling me I will do better if my blogs on Facebook, Twitter, Goodreads, et cetera, it will generate more sale? Okay, I don't like Facebook. I had a bad experience with Facebook wherein spammers broke into my site, sent a bunch of porn to my family members and friends. They thought it came from me. I got the thing shut down. Facebook blamed me for it in spite of the fact that they knew, because a whole bunch of other sites were hacked at the same time, that it was not me. They deleted all of the people from my Facebook site. And I said, screw this, close my account, and I won't go back. I won't use Facebook. They have no liability for the damage they do to you. And I had been spending hundreds of dollars a month on advertising through them. And I have to say that I wasn't getting hundreds of dollars a month in sales from that advertising either. I don't recommend them. Goodreads, I like Goodreads. But you need to have your own site. You need to have a site with your name on it, with your URL, that belongs to you, because you cannot count on anybody else's platform working for you. You cannot count on that platform not kicking you out for something that you didn't do. You can't count on that platform not turning into, what's the other site? Facebook had another, had a rival at one point, and the rival was bigger at first, and now it's a ghost town. You cannot count on that not happening to Facebook. You cannot count on that not happening to Goodreads. People get interested in things, they stay interested in them for a while, and many times they move on. I just read a statistic the other day that millions of teenagers have left Facebook because it's no longer of interest to them. The reason it's no longer of interest to them is that people my age have found it. So things change. Have your own site and run your own site and have all of your assets on your site, because your site is the thing that you can count on. Okay, can I give you some tips on how to create an interesting non-cliche female heroine? Okay, this is Yamato. You have to write what matters to you. If you write the things that matter to you, if you create a character based on what you personally are passionate about, what you fear, what you hate, what you love, what you need, what you desire, then you're not going to create a cliche, because the character you create will be unique to you. If you are looking at a book that's 50 different ways to create a character, and it gives you prototypes, or avatars, or anything else, that is saying, here is your cliche, use this. And prototypes and avatars, those aren't real people. Those are things that someone has found were a quick way to generate mediocre fiction. All right, okay, now there are still stuff up here. Okay, selling book. Okay, can you bring up a question here? Is a question, can you publish physical books through Lulu and then still just digital publish them elsewhere? Yes, Lulu doesn't take your rights. You own your rights. and they don't touch your ebook rights. They don't touch. You can have a book on Lulu and a book on CreateSpace. You can have, if you like, the wirebound, the spiral bound version of books that you can create only on Lulu, and you want to offer those to people, and you also want a perfect bound book, which is where it's the spine is glued and it's every the pages are all square cut, and it's you know, you can read the title on the back. You can get that done from CreateSpace if you want. They don't take your rights. They don't touch your rights. That's one of the things that I like about these platforms. Now, if you use the free ISBN from CreateSpace, and you do have to have an ISBN for anything that you want to sell on a bookstore that is print. You don't have to have it for your ebooks, but you have to have it for the print. If you use the free CreateSpace ISBN, then you are going to have a very difficult time selling that book on other platforms in print, because other bookstores resent, with some justification, the massive footprint that Amazon has, and they don't want to use books that are published by Amazon on their sites. So it is much better if you are print publishing through CreateSpace and Lulu and whatever, that you use your own ISBNs on these. This is something that I did not do because I didn't realize it at the time, and something that I need to start doing. I need to go back and repub my stuff, and I've got people who are helping me do that right now as soon as I get readersmeetwriters.com back up. And I will put my stuff out under my own ISBNs. Okay. Oh, Tips and Tricks is the shop plugin that I genuinely loved with WordPress. It is inexpensive. It's like $50, and it's a one-time purchase, and it works beautifully, and it has a shopping cart where people can actually add all your products to your shopping cart and get all your stuff at once if they are so inclined, instead of having to make a single separate purchase for every single thing you've got. So, Tips and Tricks. If you search Tips and Tricks WordPress plugin, that'll get you there. Tips and Tricks won't. Okay. No, and WooCommerce is not a plugin that I would recommend for anyone who is watching their bottom line, because it will be very, very expensive to use. Best software to use with your personal author page. Okay, that's a repeat. Do you recommend entering contests? I've never entered a contest. I recommend getting writing done and getting it out there in whatever format you want to get it out there in. If you think that you are going to benefit and get more readers by entering contests, then by all means, go ahead. If you think that you are going to get more readers simply by putting your stories out there and promoting them one-on-one to readers, then do that. I think contests are a good shorthand for what I wrote isn't crap. For me, my first book won a Compton Crook Award. I didn't enter a contest for it. It was just my first book, and the Baltimore writers, Baltimore has a very, very active fan base and a wonderful group. And again, the name has just slipped my mind, but the name of the award is the Stephen Tall Compton Crook Award for Best First Novel. And I won that in 1992 or 93. I don't remember now. It's been a really long time ago. And that helped me. The fact that I was an award winner from my first book helped me get some credibility. So if you have contests that you know are legit, and a legitimate contest generally is, I hate to say this because I know there are a lot of places that are trying to run legitimate contests that take payments from people who want to enter their contests. But for me, a legitimate contest is one that doesn't charge you money to enter. So, I apologize for the folks who are genuinely trying to run legitimate contests who are getting their funding through the people who are entering the contests. I know there are a few of those out there, but in general, if people want you to send in money to enter the contest, then overall, they're not legit. All right. Any suggestions for just a vanilla blogging platform? I haven't looked. All I have looked at was that everything that I did kind of scan wasn't easy to use. And again, that's Drupal, that's Joomla, if you look up CMS, in fact, if you look up free CMS, you will find hundreds of different platforms that are not WordPress upon which you can publish a website. The problem with all of these, and I tried 20 or 30 of them when I was trying to find something for Dan to show him what I wanted or something that we could move on to that was pre-built. And I came up with absolutely nothing that was not a giant pain in the ass to use. For what I have looked at so far, WordPress is the easiest, and WordPress is not easy. WordPress is all split up and broken up into pieces, and you have to go one place to do one thing and a bunch of different places to do a bunch of other things. It's confusing. It's annoying. And that is the thing that, you know, I'm trying to fix for myself and maybe for other people. Baltimore Science Fiction Society, thank you. Thank you. Yes, the folks who run Balticon, they are wonderful. Okay, now here we have, so in any case, back briefly to the question of vanilla blogging platform. There are a bunch of them out there. Just look for blogging CMS or free CMS, and you'll find a ton of things. You might find one that you don't find too obnoxious. And if it's not being upgraded every freaking week so that it breaks your stuff and makes you do tons of work that you should never have to do, then it will be a step up from WordPress right there. Okay. Corporate veil was the word that I was looking for with LLC. Yes. What kind of disclaimers does an author website need? That requires conversation with a lawyer. If you look up legal disclaimers for websites, lawyer, you will find a number of different places where you can get these. I got Business in a Box. Business in a Box is the name of the product. If you look up Business in a Box, you can get legal disclaimers there from a lawyer who stands behind his products. Don't change the wording unless you are absolutely certain you know what you're doing. And again, you know, check with a lawyer before you put anything up. But Business in a Box is what I use. I was using another guy, an actual lawyer named Chip Cooper, and his website was down when I was in urgent need of it, and I couldn't get in touch with him or with his site, so I dumped the product and moved on to something where the site wasn't down. You know, that is not a reflection on him. He might have just been having a really bad day, but it was a really bad day for me too. Okay, what are your thoughts on Smashwords? I am becoming a little warmer to Smashwords right now. They only pay quarterly, which I think sucks. And they do take a percentage on top of what you're doing. But for people who are working outside of the United States, they will take you. And they will publish your stuff for you in the United States, and they will get your money to you. And I think that is a very good thing and a big deal. So, and I know that my daughter sells just a bunch of stuff through Smashwords. I haven't decided to use them yet. I've looked at them. I've gone in a couple of times, and every time I do, I go, not yet. But I am considerably warmer to them now than I was, say, a year ago. Okay. What about hybrid publishing? Hybrid publishing is if you're selling some of your stuff commercially and you're selling some of your stuff indie publishing. I did that for 4 years, and it worked. But I was making way, way, way more money on my indie published stuff than I was making on my commercially published stuff. And I was putting more time and struggle into my commercially published stuff than I was my indie published stuff. And when you start to balance that, and on this hand, you've got your commercially published stuff that is selling very well and that you're getting all the money for, and your, I'm sorry, the indie published stuff selling very well, getting all the money, commercially published stuff, getting no money after the advance, and it's a big hassle to get in. It's a big hassle to hit the deadlines. It's a big hassle to be told, no, you can't promote the way you want to promote. And when the book does badly, you get blamed for it, in spite of the fact that they told you, no, you can't promote the way you want to promote. If you want to try it, go ahead. That's, you know, you might be the person who sells a million copies of your first book and becomes the next god of fiction. But, and if you do, that's cool. And, I wish you the best of luck with it. It's just not what worked for me. Okay. Well, I do. Okay. Here's a question. If you have your own website, how do you channel your readers if you don't do social media? Okay. I do social media in that I have a Twitter account and I have set up my blog to send notices from my blog to Twitter. Now, I know this is frowned upon, but I don't have time. I work. I'm still working 16 hours a day every day. I have started taking off weekends because of the migraines. I've got one right now. It's just, God, you only have so much time. And the thing that you spend your time on is the thing that matters to you the most. If you're spending time watching TV, that is proof that the thing that matters to you most is watching TV. If the thing that matters to you most is Twittering and blogging and chatting with people, not to the end of promoting your work, well, that's fine. But that's not who I am. I want to create. I live to write nonfiction and fiction. That is my biggest joy aside from my family. And I don't have time to do everything else. So I have had to set up little shortcuts that allow me to get my stuff out there. I have a wonderful couple of mailing lists. I have my readers mailing list and I have my writers mailing list. And these people are awesome. They send me emails, they ask me questions, and when I can, I answer them. I can't answer everything because I get way more mail in than I could possibly ever answer. But I do the best I can. When I get a really great question, I publish it in the writer's email. And emails through AWeber or any of the other legitimate publishing the other legitimate email list members, creators, any of those is social media. If you have a mailing list, you are involved in social media. I have a lot of mailing lists. I do a ton of social media. It's just not things that people think of, like Pinterest or Facebook or stuff where you're not actually working. Everything I do is work. It's just work that I really, really love. So for me, I'm working and I'm having fun at the same time. The thing I don't have fun with is building websites, and I will be very glad to be done with that. But once I'm done with that, I love to do writing workshops. I love to do fiction, and that's what I want to put my time into. Okay. Okay. Cheryl says, did you try Blogger? Actually, I started on Blogger. I got off of Blogger when I found Drupal and discovered that I could have my comments on my own system. You got to understand, when I started doing this, HTML was the only way to have a website where you had to do your own HTML and post your pages individually. I installed my very first forum from a free piece of software where I had to learn how to FTP, and I had to learn how to do permissions on files, and I had to learn how to do all of this stuff with PHP and set it all up. Actually, I don't even think it was PHP. It was something that came before PHP, which is a real step up. So, you know, I've been doing this for a really, really long time as far as the life of the internet goes. My first website was in 1976. My first forum was in 1996. And my first forum was in 1997. So, yeah, I've used a lot of stuff. I used, there was no way to have comments on your blog. And then Drupal came out with comments on your blog. And so I moved to Drupal. And from Drupal, I moved to WordPress because WordPress was easier to use. Drupal is very difficult to use. And then I moved to Joomla for a while, and I didn't update my site for a year on Joomla because Joomla sucks. It is just so convoluted. It does not work anything like the way I think, and I hated it. I hated it. I hated it. So then I went back to WordPress. And I had to pay somebody to move me back to WordPress because Joomla is so convoluted that I couldn't figure out how to do that on my own. So anyway, I used Dreamweaver for a while. But yeah, I tried Blogger. And if Blogger had had comments when I started using it, I probably would have stayed with Blogger. But Blogger does not let you also build a website. And see, what I was also doing at the same time was I was building pages. I had all of these articles that I've still got up there, you know, about 100,000 words worth of free stuff on how to write fiction and a whole bunch of chapters from my books and just these pages of stuff that I was putting out there because I could and because my publisher didn't make me stop. Okay, so I've got somebody here who's saying, I hesitate to suggest this because it's not live yet, but Readership Pro is a group of authors, publishers building a website host system specifically for authors intending to be easy to use for folks who don't speak code. Okay, well, that's cool. And that's Readership Pro, just like readership and then pro.com. I can't recommend it. I've never heard of it, but I will put the plug out there for Tammy. Tips on finding an editor. That's one of the things that we are working on in readersmeetwriters.com, in howtothinksideways.com. If you go in and you click the free service or the recommended services, you will find my editor in there who gives a discount to howtothinksideways.com members. If I recommend my editor. He does a very good job on my work. My work would be much better if I didn't then go in after I had gotten my edits done and change things again because I am horrible at editing my own work. I don't see mistakes. I see mistakes in the story flow and in things like that, but in places where I have the same word twice and stuff like that, I don't see it. Okay. Aside from that, ask other writers who they recommend. Okay, check draft to digital instead of Smashwords. Okay, so draft to digital, recommended by Tammy, is another site that where you can publish your work. I don't know whether they work for foreign writers. And when I say foreign, I am saying foreign as in not a citizen of the United States or living in the U.S. I understand that everybody is local to their own place. Okay. And let's see, I use you as an example of success in one of my blogs to illustrate a point I was making. I just thought you would like to know that. Thanks. All right, that is all the questions, that is all the answers, and we have really run over on the time, but I really hope this was worth it. What I am going to do before I leave is one more time, I'm going to recommend that you click pop in on the right-hand side of this, and that If you don't get the download from the pop-in now, go to howtothinksideways.com, create a free member account, And you will be able, I'm going to put up the link as soon as I finish this. I'm going to copy off this and post it as one of the live chats in the site. And I will put the download with it. And I will have the link up in there for this when you go in. So that is everything. Thank you. You guys have been wonderful. The questions were wonderful. And I had a wonderful time. And I hope you did too.